Harper Audio presents What She Saw by Gerard Stembridge, performed by Saskia Maarleveld and by me, the author. Friday, October 26, 2012. 1 p.m. Ferdy hated the way Villette moved. Right now, he was padding round the suite imperiale, nose up, accusatory eyes flicking left and right. A Doberman bred to notice something everyone else had missed. The place had already been swept twice by his own meatheads, for fuck's sake. Bending slightly, he probed underneath a random cushion. Fingered a lampstand like he was about to reveal an undetected mic or camera. Then padded out onto the terrace to lean over the barrier and discover... what? An army of intrepid Front National wall climbers? Then back inside, holding himself so still. Apart from that god-awful clicking of fingernail on fingernail, Ferdy really, truly hated that. Chin up, left ear cocked, detecting sounds inaccessible to the mere humans in the room, especially any sounds that might suggest danger for his master. Always alert, potentially lethal. What a prick. Then Villette did the thing Ferdy hated most of all. He walked toward him without looking directly at him. He pointed accusingly at the leather folder on the coffee table. All cleared, except for number 7 and 15. Denied. Ferdy didn't open the dossier to check the headshots of numbers 7 and 15, nor ask for a reason why they were not acceptable. He knew it was just Villette's little power trip, controlling everything while at the same time making it coldly, no, neurotically clear that he wanted nothing to do with this party, that he despised the very idea of it, that it turned his stomach, that it was only because it was his master, Monsieur Fournier's, desire. It was Villette's mode to treat all underlings as underlings, but Ferdy recognised the special contempt reserved for him as if he was not just workaday inferior, but morally inferior. Not so much chauffeur as pimp, to be tolerated only because Monsieur Fournier wanted him around. So when Villette demanded a dossier of all the party girls Ferdy had arranged for tonight, it had given him special pleasure to withhold one photo. Caramel Girl, as Ferdy liked to think of her, remained a JPEG on his laptop. Villette had not been given the opportunity to veto this one. Ferdy, knowing this was a potentially dangerous thing to do, had nonetheless decided to take the risk. Caramel Girl would not arrive with the other girls. He would meet her alone later in the hotel bar, and would bring her up to the party when Villette was no longer around and the dossier had been forgotten in favour of Monsieur Fournier's urgent requirements. If Ferdy knew his master, then Caramel Girl would flick his inner switch. He had seen enough of him on these occasions to recognise the special moment with the special girl when suddenly the master's body became slightly hunched and hard, the focus in the eyes narrowed, the hands taking on a life of their own. Ferdy was banking on his luscious creme brulee having this effect and more. All going well, he'd earn kudos from Monsieur Fournier, and maybe even a little gratitude from Caramel Girl. Villette would find out about it, but too late. Of course, Ferdy would then have to be very, very wary. What was it about these number two guys like Villette? Something in the head with all of them. He'd seen it before in other employments. They were like crazy wives. A top layer of unctuous, cloying loyalty to the master. But a little digging discovered something else entirely. Ownership, jealousy, homoerotic impulse. Or was the real truth that they all thought they were the puppeteers and the master owed them everything? Everything. Whatever the reason, from Ferdy's perspective, their attitude made them a real ass pain to deal with, and sometimes, as was more and more the case with Villette, genuinely intimidating. It was one thing to be casually despised by him, quite another to make him your enemy. After Villette and the meatheads had left via the suite imperiale's private elevator, without even the most perfunctory goodbye, Ferdy took particular pleasure in immediately stretching out on the silk-covered chaise longue in his shoes. He turned on his laptop and opened the JPEG of Caramel Girl to full screen. He gazed at her impossibly delicious skin and couldn't resist leaning in to tip his tongue to her lips. Tonight in the hotel bar, he would brush close to her once more, speak to her one-on-one, then cross the foyer together, into the elevator and up to the Imperial Suite. A minute alone with her was better than nothing. Ferdy forced himself to focus on work. He opened the leather dossier to remind himself who numbers 7 and 15 were. Cecile and Denise. Pretty dirty bitches, naturally, but neither of special interest to Monsieur Fournier, so no great loss. He removed their profiles and dialed Cecile's number first. It would be basic courtesy to call directly and let them know the bad news.
In this mood, running yellows is fun. Oh, the big fat yes of that moment. No more than a wink. A come on before the brake slamming red. With any luck, angry horns would cheer her on. She had run through three on her way to the airport. At least 1.5 minutes of her life won back. The security line steals that, and more. Finally through the screening without a beep. But then a grim face. Open the bag, please. Mouthwash. 300 milliliters. Forbidden. How was she supposed to know that was in there? She had packed so fast. Oh, take it, but don't give me that look. Lana knows enough not to say that out loud. On the plane at last, and it's hard not to glare at the fat suits and giddy families who have stolen the first three rows. Seat 4D is fine, she tells herself, for a last-minute reservation. And no one in 4E. Good. All good. As soon as possible after takeoff, Lana slips earbuds in and pumps up Siamese Dream as loud as she dares. Her eyes shut. The pumpkin's angsty stoner energy crowd surfs her all the way back, nearly 20 years to unstoppable 16. One more time around the whole album gets her all the way to the final descent. The tap on the shoulder from the stewardess. Yeah, turn off all electronic equipment. I know. It's hard not to say that out loud. Left now to its frenetic self, Lana's brain flashes with those images of the Suite Impériale on the Hotel de Chevalier website. 7th floor penthouse, all silk and velvet, gold thread by the yard, the sumptuous canopy bed, and outside an enormous terrace with the Eiffel Tower looming. No online booking, contact the hotel. She'd had no patience for that, obviously. For a few seconds, though, she'd craved its excesses and considered it an outrageous treat. The landing bump high at Charles de Gaulle gradually deflates during the endless approach to the gate. They must have taxied to Belgium by now. Lana sings Luna under her breath as the lyrics urge her to take chances. She slyly unbuckles her seatbelt so that the moment she hears the bing, she springs from 4D and retrieves her duffel, while wriggling forward until her momentum is halted by a wedge of fat suits. In what airline world does a wheelie case, a laptop shoulder bag, a little briefcase, and a bulging duty-free bag count as one piece of hand luggage? Still, third in line to exit is hardly a worst-case scenario. Once disembarked, its earbuds back in. Lana overtakes the fat boys, and with today pounding at full volume this time, opens an impressive gap hurtling along the great looping, moving walkway that sags way down, as if depressed by the weight of so many millions of passengers, then surges up resolutely at the end. Recurring images of a model in severe profile, wearing a little Eiffel Tower strapped to her head, are eye-catching, but Lana doesn't slow down to check out what the radical millinery is advertising. She silences the pumpkins at passport control, which is default surly, but at least hassle-free. Unlike back in her old single days when the Lana Turner passport always produced a crooked grin and a fun comment, and required the fakest fake feminine giggle from her in response. You guys, never heard that one before. Lana remembers how at every hotel, car rental office, bureau de change, and airport, she would again and again try not to curse poor, drug-crazed, now-deceased Josh and Rosie Turner, who in the uninterrupted high of the summer of 1977 had thought it would be such a super cool out-of-sight idea to name the newborn accidental child of their love, Lana. The same child who by 1980 they would only discuss through their respective lawyers. But now at Charles de Gaulle passport control, just like everywhere else since she became Mrs. Lana Gibson, her passport scarcely merits a glance before it slid back to her. briefly registering the bland, contented married lady mugshot before she slaps it shut and sails on. Lana is struck by the chasm between the image and the real woman clutching it, and is buzzed to feel more Lana Turner than she has for quite some time. The bad and the beautiful Lana. The postman always rings twice, Lana. Of course, she knows that this feeling is not a good thing. Lana Gibson knows it too well. But it's such a good feeling. With no luggage to collect, she's through Salt T-34 in less time than it takes to listen to Geek USA, which means more of her life snatched back. A ray of late afternoon sun nudging into a corner under the joyless gray concrete overhang outside Terminal 1 entices her. She could hop a cab immediately and keep the momentum going, but Lana Turner needs a cigarette. The recent urge to buy her first pack of cigarettes in over a year had been her own first warning of the mood change. The actual purchase of that pack had been confirmation. And yet it had been several days later before the defiant lighting up and luxuriant draw that signaled a great big hi to the buzz. That lovely buzz. Welcome back. Take me out, honey. Lana opens a new pack and plucks one out and lights up. And she's thinking of Brian now, though she doesn't want to. Even when he'd noticed the signs of elation, even when she'd told him to butt out and try not to be so lame, she'd be fine, and this needed to happen every so often. It was part of who she was, right? Even when she'd laughed at his tentative suggestion to go see her doctor and get the necessary meds, Lana had still hidden the cigarettes from him, knowing that particular fall from grace would have made her husband so sad. It might have even made him feel that the ship had finally sailed. She couldn't be 100% sure about that part. But still, she could not, would not, do that to him. Even though in this mood, Brian's feelings meant about as little to her as anyone else's feelings. Which was to say, pretty much not at all. So here, now in the sterile no man's land of Charles de Gaulle Airport smoking zone, alone, framed in that encouraging little rectangle of sunshine, she enjoys lighting up and sucking. As she blows smoke and holds her hand aloft in a studied pose, she notices her wedding band next to the cigarette and has a sudden memory of just such a gesture, just such a moment. Nathan, her last time in Paris. Forget that. Lana Turner is in charge now, and she revels in the villainy of flicking the half cigarette away before plucking the band from her finger with elan and aiming for the taxi line. 5 p.m. The suite impériale is not available. The receptionist at Le Chevalier tells Lana in perfect, almost accentless English. Though the young woman's skin is crème fraîche and her eyes are pods of luxury bath oil, her smile is enamel sealed, and she makes Lana feel rather foolish for having even considered that such an awesome prize could be had just for the asking. To anyone. But the junior suites are superb. Superb, madame. You will be very happy. Lana had known all along that the suite impériale would not be available. The whole point of such a facility is that access to it is almost impossible. But what if? Would she really have gone for it? At any price? How expensive could it be for only one night? How would Brian have reacted to that indulgence? The bellhop's smile seems more genuine than the receptionist's, its warmth rising all the way to amber eyes she'd like to crawl into and be preserved in. Lana's wheelie duffel feels so light, holding only a cotton dress and bow pumps, extra underwear, and anything else it had occurred to her to toss in before she got bored with packing. That having it carried seems a little embarrassing. But you get what you pay for, and it would be plain wrong not to enjoy the pleasure of that gorgeous face smiling her to the fifth floor. As he explains how the room keycard also operates the elevator, she wonders why a certain kind of French accent in English manages to sound naive and erotic at the same time. She wants to close her eyes and let it shiver through her, but instead tries to affect an interest in what he is explaining to her.
And the card only works on your level. You cannot, for example, use this to go to level 3 or 6 or...
Lana now notices that the elevator only goes as far as 6.
Am I wrong? Did I read on the website that this famous Suite Imperiale is on the 7th floor?
Yes, that is correct.
His quizzical look is adorable. Lana smiles.
But the elevator. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.